we start?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me just recollect. We first had the notion of an open set. So we have a metric space X row, and then we say A in X is an open set if the interior of A is equal to A. That is, every point is an interior point. So what does this mean? That is, for every A in A, there exists some radius such that the ball with the radius A or around A is completely contained in A. This is what we defined as the notion of an open set. And then we had the major properties of open set. So we denoted by G the collection of all open sets in X row. Then we had the following properties: the empty set and the whole set are open set, and the union of any collection, finite, countably infinite or uncountably infinite open sets is open. So A alpha in G implies union alpha A alpha is G. So the indexing set can be finite or countably infinite, countably infinite. And three, if we have a finite number of open sets, then their intersection is also an open set. So the open sets are close with respect to arbitrary union and close with respect to finite intersection. This is what is meant by saying close with respect, that is self-contained with respect to arbitrary union, and they are self-contained with respect to finite intersection. And we also made one more observation, namely that A naught is the smallest, is the largest open set contained in A, and is the union of all open sets contained in A. Largest open set that can be embedded inside, and that is obtained as the union of all possible open sets which are inside. Then we introduce the notion of closed sets, and we define A is said to be closed set if and only if A complement is an open set. Okay. So, if complement is an open set, then A is a closed set. So, all these properties get complemented, and therefore, we have complement of X is phi and complement of phi is X. So, let F denote the collection of all closed sets in X row. Then we had the properties that X and phi are closed sets, and closed sets are self-contained with respect to intersections, arbitrary intersections, and closed sets are in F implies union J equal to 1 to N A J. So the open sets are closed, are self contained with respect to arbitrary union, closed sets are self contained with respect to arbitrary intersection, open sets are self contained with respect to finite intersection, closed sets are self contained with respect to finite union. So everything gets complemented, Then we also introduce the notion of the closure. Closure of A denoted by A closure is the intersection of all closed sets containing A, and it is the smallest closed set containing A. So inside the largest open set is the interior A naught, outside the smallest closed set is the closure of A. So these are all the various aspects, important aspects that we had in the last lecture. Okay. So now we will look at the closed sets from a different point of view. Okay. So we will now introduce the notion of limit point of a set. If I introduce all the basic notions in the metric space, then I can use anywhere else, whether it is a norm space, inner product space, everywhere else I can use this, and these are all fundamental notions. Okay, again I have X row, a metric space, and A is a subset of X. So I have this metric space and inside that I have a set. Let me draw it a little bigger so that that's A. Okay. So now I am going to look at a point X naught which is in the metric space. It may be in A, it may not be in A. So consider a point X naught in X, not necessarily in A. It may or may not be. I am not insisting that it be any point in the metric space I am going to pick. So what I am going to do is, suppose it is there, X naught outside, let us draw both the pictures. And suppose it is here. So I could pick it outside X, or it could be inside X also. So either way. So I am going to look at a point X naught. Now let us look at this picture. In this picture, suppose I can isolate this point from points of A. What do I mean by saying that isolate points from A? You take any neighborhood, or you are able to construct a neighborhood such that nobody else from A is there. Okay. Then I can isolate. If I cannot isolate, means what? Whatever neighborhood I take, there will be a fellow of A sitting in. Okay. So what I am saying is that if I draw any open ball of radius R, it must have somebody from A. Now in this case, whatever ball I draw, I already have a point of A, but that is not counted. Some other point of A, then I call it a limit point. In other words, X naught is called a limit point if you draw any neighborhood of it, there is a non-central point in that ball which is from A. Okay. So then it is called a limit point. X naught is called a limit point of the set A if for every R greater than 0, whatever radius you choose, then you look at the open ball of radius r about that point x naught, and remove the center. Probably you will have to remove the center, probably heat from A. So other than the center, you look at the ball, then its intersection with A is non-empty. That is, at least one more point of A is there. We will make this definition a little some other way, we will look at it. That is, every open ball centered at x naught has at least one point of A inside, one point of A other than the center inside A, because the center could possibly in A. Okay. So, other than the center, one more point of A must be there. Then we call it a limit point. So whatever you do, you are not able to avoid points of A. That fellow is, even if he is in A, he does not want anybody else to come near him. And if he is not in A, he does not want anybody in A to come near him. Okay, that's what, then that point is isolated. If not, is limit point. Is that clear? We look at this definition and slightly modify, you see another way of putting at it. Okay. Let me draw a picture. So suppose x naught is the limit point of A. So I have a set A and x naught is a limit point of A. Okay. Then take any r greater than 0. And look at V R X naught. So I'll draw a big picture here. Here is X naught, and that's the radius R. So this is V R X. So I'm going to look at the open ball of radius R about the point X naught. Now because X naught is a limit point, there will be one point of A inside this, and that point will be different from the center point. So therefore, let me call it as x1. We call it, okay, x1. So therefore, there exists x1 in A, x1 not equal to x0, such that x1 belongs to V or it is in A, it is different from X naught, and it is inside this open ball. So if X naught is a limit point, you draw any open ball about it, there is at least one fellow outside the center but inside the ball, and he comes from A. Right. So now, since X1 is not equal to X naught, we have the radius of the distance between X1 and X naught will be strictly positive, because the metric is 0 if and only if the two points are equal. So rho of x1 x0 is greater. So now what I am going to do is, I am going to choose r1, which is half of this, and that will be strictly greater than 0. Okay. That is, in other words, I am looking at this distance and taking half that distance, right. Now I am going to draw, look at BR1 X0. In other words, I am going to draw, let me call it, an open ball whose radius is now R1, which is half this distance. The radius is half of this distance. Right, that radius is half of that. This is a concentric sphere, actually. concentric open ball whose radius is half of the distance between x naught and x 1, though in the picture it looks like slightly distorted. Okay. Well, I am not using the standard metric, it would be an arbitrary metric. Okay. Now, since x naught is a limit point, any open ball around x naught must have a point of A. So, this open ball must also have a point of A which is other than x naught. Okay. So, since x naught is a limit point of A, there exists now x 2. That point has to be different from this because it has to lie inside. X 2 not equal to x 1 and x naught. It cannot be center also. X 2 belonging to A and x 2 belongs to such that x 2 belongs to B or 1 x naught. There is x 2. Now the ball game is clear. What do? I take this radius and half of it and put a B or 2. Inside I will get an x 3. So, what we conclude? All these points are inside this original ball. So, in other words, given any open ball about x naught, we have an infinite number of points of A inside this. So, this B or x naught is contained in B or x 1, B or x naught, and continuing this process, we see that x naught is a limit point of A implies for every r greater than 0, B or x naught intersection A is infinite set. Of course, the converse is obvious. If it is an infinite set, at least one point is there and therefore it must be limit point. So, x naught is a limit point if and only if every open ball is very rich of points of A. Okay. A is infiltrates every, A infiltrates every open ball about that point x naught infinite number of times. So, one breach takes place, that flow tries to close it up, another breach takes place, and that flow tries to close it up, another breach takes place. So, he is not able to stop the breach. Then it is called a limit point. So, a limit point is something which is in every neighborhood of it, there is a rich collection of points of A. That is what is meant by a limit point. Let us look at some very simple examples, because after we start dealing with the main subject, we will find several such instances. So, just to start with some examples, let us take the metric space X row to be the usual real numbers with the usual metric. Now, let us take the set A to the interval 0, 1, where 1 is included, 0 is not included. Now, you see that every point including 1 between 0 and 1 is a limit point. For example, take 0, 1, take any point inside. You draw any neighborhood, there are plenty of points A. And you take 1, draw any neighborhood, still there are points of A. And you take 0 and draw any neighborhood, there are plenty of points of A. So, every point between 0 and 1 is a limit point. You take anything outside this interval, you can always avoid points of. So, what are the limit points of this? So, every point in 0, 1, closed interval 0, 1 is is a limit point of A, and no other point is limit point. Suppose I take the closed interval. Again, same limit points. Okay, so again, 0, 1 gives us all limit points. So therefore, the sets may be different, but the limit points may turn out to be the same. Let's look at, in that same space, the set of all natural numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What are the limit points? None of the points is a limit point. So let us look at this 1, 2, 3, etc. And somewhere is n, etc. Now, if you take any point other than this, then there is always a root which is free from points of A. So nobody other than this can be a limit point. But if you take any one of these points, I can isolate it all the other points of N, and the only point will be the center, and we want a point other than the center. So none of these points is, so no point is a limit point. So let us take A to be the set of all rational numbers. Q stands for quotients, m by n, rational numbers, the set of all rational numbers. What are the limit points? Everything is a limit point, because if you take any real numbers and take any neighborhood, there will be plenty of rational numbers inside. So, every x in R is limit point. Similarly, if I take A to be the set of all irrational, the every x in R is a limit point, because every neighborhood of every real number contains both irrationals and rationals, and therefore they are all limit points. Let me set, take the set to be the set of all numbers of the form 1 by n, where n is an integer. So 1, half, one third, one fourth, one fifth, etc. What is the limit point? 0 is the only limit point. Every other point is, can be isolated out. Okay. So in this case, 0 is the only limit point. X equal to 0 is the only limit point. For the time being, we will keep these examples. Now, in all these examples, you will see that sometimes some limit points are there, some limit points are not there, all limit points are there, infinite number of limit points are not there, the only none of the limit points are there. All possibilities can take place. The limit points, some of them may not belong to A, all of them may not belong to A, and everybody may belong to A. So now what we are going to do is, we are going to collect all these limit points. So let X row be a metric space, and A subset of X, D dA is called the derived set of A. So that's the notation dA. dA is the set of all limit points of A. Okay, so now I'm going to collect all the limit points in a basket, and that basket is called dA. Now dA, part of dA may be in A, full of dA may be in A, none of dA may be in A. All possibilities exist. And dA in fact may be even empty. There may not be any limit points also. So dA may be empty, dA intersection A may be empty, dA intersection A may not be empty, dA intersection A complement may also be not empty. All possibilities exist. So we call this dA the collection of all limit points of A. So for example, in 1, what is dA? It is the closed interval 0, 1. In example 2, dA is closed interval 0, 1. In example 3, dA is the empty set. There is no limit point at all. In this example, dA is R. In this example, dA is R. And in this example, dA consists of the singleton point 0. Okay. So dA may be empty, singleton, finite, or infinitely many also. Okay. So now we have this notion of this, all these limit points. What I am going to do is, I am going to define a new set with A union dA. What does that mean? Whatever limit points of A which are not in A are now supplemented. All the limit points of A have been appended. Are not there. If they are already there, no problem. If they are not there, I am going to append them all to A and make it a bigger basket. Okay. Now it turns out, we will see that. First of all, okay. Claim 1. We will prove them one by one. A hat is a closed. This is a close. A may or may not be a closed set. By appending all the limit points, it becomes a closed set. That is the first claim. The second claim that we are going to make is the following. And of course, A is contained or equal to 5, because A hat is A, maybe some more points have been appended to A, A union something. So, A is already there in A hat. So, therefore, A hat is a closed set which contains A. But we know that A closure is the smallest closed set that contains A. So, therefore, A closure must be sitting inside A hat. Okay. So, A closure is contained in A because A closure is the smallest closed set containing A. This is one closed set containing A, this is one closed set containing A, this must be smaller, therefore A closure is contained in A hat. Claim 3, so claim 2 is obvious from claim 1. Okay. The moment you know A hat is closed, immediately you can conclude A closure must be smaller than A hat. Claim 3 is, let me put it this way. Every limit point of A is contained in A closure. consequence. A is contained in A cluster, Di and therefore A and Di will be contained in A closure. That means A hat will be contained in A closure. Okay. Claim 4, A hat is contained in A closure because A is contained in A closure, Di is contained in A closure. Now, from claim 4 and claim 2, we get A closure is final. Therefore, proposition A closure is A hat. So, what it says is the closure is actually obtained by there is these holes in A. The holes are the limit points are missing. So, you fill them up, you get the closure. So, A closure is A. So, it's got the closure of A is obtained by supplementing all the missing limit points of. So, in this, for example, claim 1 was obvious, or claim 1 was not obvious, this has to be not yet proved, this was obvious, this was not yet, and this was obvious. So, it is this claim 1 and 3 that lack argument. Okay. So, we shall now look at. In the beginning I will prove these things because so that makes the definitions clear and the usual tricks for proving these things become clear. Okay, so proof of claim 1. I will just write briefly. We want to show that A hat is closed. How do you show something is closed? Complement should be open. So, I will write here enough to show that A hat complement is open. Now, to show that something is open, what should we do? Every point is an interior point. Okay. So, enough to show that A belongs to A closure implies A is an interior point. Right. Now, to show that something is an interior point, what should we show? There must be a open ball which is in that. So, interior point of, I should say, interior point of A closure complement. Okay. Therefore, enough to show that A belongs to A closure implies there exists R greater than 0 such that B or A is completely contained in A closure complement. This is what we have to show. Okay. Suppose not. Oh, what should I say? I have to show A closure, A hat prime is open. Okay. So, suppose not. What does that mean? The reason A, which is in A hat prime, such that there is no ball around it, which is completely contained in A hat prime. Then there exists A in A hat prime such that for every R greater than 0, B or A intersection A hat will be not empty. Right? That is what it means. There is no ball means every ball has somebody from outside. Now, what does that mean? Here is A. You draw any ball around it, there is a point of A hat, but that cannot be A because A is sitting in the complement. So, there is a point of A hat which is other than the center. What does that mean? A must be a, every ball about A has a point of A hat. Therefore, A must be a limit point of A hat. Okay. Implies A is a limit point of A hat. Now, what does that say? Yeah? A belongs to Y. Okay, let's put it this way. Let me even put it this way. There is an X. Let me draw a bigger picture, okay, so that it becomes much more clear. Okay. Because this is the first time I am proving, let me make it more clear. So here is A, draw a bigger picture. Here is R, and that is X. X is in. There are two possibilities. X is in A hat means X is in A or X is in DA. If X is in A, we get that in this ball there is a point of X, and therefore there will be a, this will be a limit point. Every ball has a point of X, point of A hat, and therefore it is a limit point of A. On the other hand, if it is not in A, where will it be? DA. Now therefore draw a smaller circle, smaller sphere, the radius half of this. Because this is a limit point, there will be a point of A inside that. Right? So at any rate, you draw any ball around the point A, there will be a point of A inside this little fellow. And therefore, this little center must be a limit point of the set A. If it is a limit point of the set A, it belongs to DA, and therefore it belongs to A hat. And but we started with A belonging to A hat complement. Okay. So let me write that. So this plus this picture will imply A belongs to DA, which belongs to A, belongs to A hat, contradiction, because A belongs to A hat prime. Okay. And therefore our starting point, suppose not, is false. You assume that this was not true, then you end up in a contradiction. This is the standard proof by contradiction. You assume otherwise and get at a contradiction. So A hat is a closed set. Now we have to show almost similar argument. We have to show that DA is a part of A closure. So we want to prove that DA is a part of A closure. Suppose not. Then what happens? There will be a point of which is not in A closure. So there exists A belonging to DA, such that A does not belong to A closure. Right? That is what is meant by saying that DA is not part of A closure. Now A does not belong to A closure means A belongs to A closure complement. What can I say about A closure complement? It is an open set. Because A closure is closed, its complement must be open. So that says, because this is an open set, such that there exists R greater than 0, BR A is completely contained in A closure complement. Okay. Now what does that say? There is no point of A. Okay. Okay. Let me even write this. A belongs to A such that B R A intersection A closure is empty. Because the whole thing lies in A closure complement, so therefore its intersection with A closure will be empty. If its intersection with A closure itself is empty, its intersection with A will be empty, because A is a part of A closure, which means in this open ball there is no point of A. If there is no point of A, then center cannot be a limit point. So that says A does not belong to DA. We started with a A concluded as a contradiction. Okay. So these are some of the round and round arguments we will go on making. Therefore, what we have is the closure that we obtain, which is the smallest closed set that embeds A, that encloses A, is obtained by simply supplementing all the missing limit points. And of course, if already has all its limit points, then A closure will be A itself. Because everything is here, then we don't need this. A hat will be A and A hat is A closure, therefore A will be A closure. Okay, so that's the way to look at A closure. So we can look at A closure at the intersection of all closed sets containing A. We can also look at A closure as A appended with all limit points to it. If any missing, add them all, then you get the closure. Okay, so these notions of open sets and closed sets are very crucial. They are the fundamental topological ideas. Okay. The next important topological idea that introduced is convergence, which is bread and butter in all our analysis. Okay. All the analysis we will do will be some kind of convergence analysis. So, the next important notion is convergence in a metric space. So, probably what I will do is, I will split the board into two parts and on the one side, I will write what we know. By that, I mean that whatever we are supposed to know are real numbers, and then generalize them. Okay. The generalization I will write in the other part of the board. Okay. So, I will split the board in two parts. I will take my standard metric space, which everybody knows, the real numbers. On the other side, I will write a general metric space X row. So, the first thing in convergence is I take a sequence of real numbers. So, I take a sequence of real numbers. That means they are all elements of the metric space R. Okay, they are all in R. So, I take a sequence of real numbers R and X naught is another real number. Then we say Xn, the sequence Xn converges to X naught if. Now, what is meant by convergence? Really, it says distance between these two polos is getting negligible. So, that negligibility, how negligible is negligible? You tell me how negligible you want to be, then I will make it that much. Okay. So, if you tell me what is your the negligibility distance you permit or the tolerance error, okay. Epsilon stands for the error. What is your tolerance limit for the error? You can prescribe arbitrarily, but prescribe it as a positive error. Don't say zero error. Okay. So, given any tolerance positive error, that's you have played your card. You have played the epsilon card. Now, I am going to play a reply card. Namely, there exists a positive integer n which will depend on epsilon. When you play a card, you don't play blindly another card. You see what card your opponent has played and then accordingly suitably reply your card. So, I see what is the epsilon you played and based on that I am going to play a card on positive integer. What should be the result such that whenever you take any member beyond that stage, beyond the card stage I have put, and look at its distance from this x naught, and that fellow will approximate it within the error epsilon. Any member of the sequence, any term of the sequence beyond my chord stage will approximate that x naught within your tolerance limit epsilon. So therefore, in order to obtain this tolerance limit, I should decide how far I should go in the sequence, and based on your epsilon, I will tell you how far you should go and chop off the head, and then the remaining tail will all be within an error epsilon for x naught. So this is the formal definition of convergence to x naught. Now, the only difference will be, instead of the modulus distance, we have a general metric there. So therefore, immediate generalization is xn sequence in a metric space x naught, in metric space x row, and x naught belongs to x. All this now is shifted. The universe is changed from the real universe to an abstract metric space. Then we say xn converges to x naught if, same card game is played. You tell me the tolerance limit, I will tell you the stage at which you should cut off that sequence head. Then if you look at what remains, you cut off the sequence head up to the NF, then remaining sequence, you take anybody. Now this has to be replaced by rho of xn x naught is less than. That is what is the meaning of convergence in a metric space. Okay. So based on, you may have the same set, but based on what metric you use, we will have different notions of convergence. Every metric on the same set will give a different notion of convergence. Okay. We'll see examples. Okay, we'll see a number of examples of this. Now, in the real numbers, we know that if a sequence converges to x naught, that limit is unique. The same sequence cannot converge to two different limits. That is, if a sequence converges, the sequence of real numbers converges, then the limit is unique. Right. So I will use one notation. If this happens, we will write either limit n tending to infinity xn equal to x naught. That is our short way of writing. Or we will say xn tends to x naught. One of the two notations we will use. The same notation I will use here also. Limit n tending to infinity xn is x1. That is the notation I will write. Or xn tends to xn. I will use both the, when this happens, we will write this. So, in the real number case, if a sequence converges, then the limit is unique. Why? Let's first, okay, so let me split the board again here, and I'll write here R and an X. I'm continuing 2 here, 2 continued. After that I'll come back to this, to the metric space, and see what 2 there is. So why is that unique? So sub for the reason. Suppose xn converges to x naught and xn converges to y naught, right? We want to show that x naught must be equal to y naught. So we want to show that number, we are going to generalize this. So when we are going to generalize this, we will have a similar situation in metric space. And the only way I know in a metric space to show that x naught is equal to y naught is to show that rho x naught y naught equal to 0. So what is the corresponding version here? Mod x naught minus y naught I must show equal to 0. So that is what we will show. Okay. So that is to show that mod x naught minus y naught. Now we see, I had a grandfather who used to sit by my side and look at what I am studying or writing. I used to write some very big expression and write equal to 0. He used to ask me, if it is equal to 0, why did you write all this? It is just 0, why did you write such a big expression and then say it is equal to 0? So we struggle many times to say that it is 0. Okay? So now we are going to go round up so something is 0. How do you say that some number is 0? I do not know it is 0. I will say that it is smaller, it is modulus is already non-negative. So therefore, I know this. So I want to show that the greater part will not take place, right? I want to really show that mod x naught y naught cannot be greater than 0. So therefore, what I will do is, I will show that it is smaller than every positive number. See, to show that something non-negative is 0, we show that it is smaller than every positive number and therefore the only hope for it is to be 0. So that is to show that mod x naught minus y naught is less than epsilon for every epsilon positive. And now we in business, because that epsilon comes into the picture, that is the card I will play. Here is something very funny. I will write it as epsilon 1. You may say, why do you want to put epsilon 1? Some people have a very neat knack of remembering everything and adjusting everything correctly so that at the end epsilon comes. I do not know what epsilons I have to adjust. So I will write this and then we will adjust that. Okay. So we want to show that it is less than epsilon 1 for every epsilon 1 positive. Okay. So this is our goal. How are we going to achieve it? Now I know that I can make xn and x naught close enough. I can make xn and y naught close enough, and therefore xn naught and y naught must be close enough. This is what the general argument is. He is related to me and he is related to him, therefore this is some more related. Okay. So that's what exactly we are going to do. Okay. By convergence we have given any epsilon positive, we can find an n1 epsilon such that n greater than or equal to n1 epsilon implies mod xn minus x naught is less than epsilon. Right? That is the convergence. Because xn converges to x naught, beyond a certain stage, they must all be within an error of epsilon. Let me continue here. I will write all this. This is just to show many a times, as we go along, you will find that in
other cases we do even worse things to show that something is zero. Okay, very hard work we will show that. All right. Similarly, we also have x n con. So corresponding to that, there will be another n. So there exists an n epsilon 2, such that n greater than or equal to n epsilon 2 implies mod x n minus y naught is less than epsilon. I'm sorry, this is, I should write here, okay. Y naught is less than epsilon. Right. Now what does this say? Here is the sequence. If we chop off at this stage, everything is close to x naught. If we chop off at this stage, everything is close to y naught. So if we chop off at the bigger stage, everything is both close to x naught and y naught. Therefore, if n epsilon is the bigger of the two, then n greater than or equal to n epsilon implies mod x n minus x naught is less than epsilon, and also mod x n minus y naught is less than epsilon. I am deliberately doing all these things because this is the sort of estimate that you will normally be doing in convergence analysis. Okay. So therefore, what does that say? Therefore, mod x n minus x naught will be less than, because beyond n greater than n epsilon, n greater than or equal to n epsilon, this is true. So in particular, n equal to n epsilon, this will be true, and similarly n equal to n epsilon, that will be true. Okay. Now what happened? Therefore, mod x minus x naught minus y naught is less than or equal to mod x naught minus n epsilon plus mod x n epsilon minus y naught, right? Going from x naught to y naught, I go to x n epsilon and then come to y naught, triangle inequality, and that is less than epsilon and that is also less than epsilon. So mod x naught minus y naught is less than 2 epsilon. So what do I do? What was I wanting to prove? So what should I choose epsilon to be? So this is true for any epsilon greater than 0. Given this epsilon 1, choose epsilon to be epsilon 1 by 2, then I will get x naught minus y naught will be less than epsilon 1. This is true for any epsilon 1, and therefore it is 0. Okay. So choose epsilon is equal to epsilon 1 by 2. Right. Therefore, x naught minus y naught in modulus is less than every possible positive real number, and therefore it must be 0, and therefore x naught must be equal to y naught. Okay. Now, what about the argument for metric space? Exactly same, except wherever there is modulus x naught a minus b, we should write rho a by. Okay, so say similar argument holds. Holds, and any sequence converging must have unique limit. Now this is sort of a consequence of the fact that these topologies are kind of Hausdorff topologies. Wherever there is Hausdorffian nature, this will happen. The limits will be unique. Okay. So now we know what is convergence. We know what is that whenever something converges, the limit must be unique. Now there is a slight problem in this definition. If you look at this definition of convergence, I say xn converges to x if this happens. Okay. That means it already presupposes I know x naught. I already know the limit, right? Or if you give me some x naught, I can verify whether it is a limit or not. So suppose I don't know, then you take an arbitrary x naught and see whether it satisfies the definition, and then you can decide whether it's a limit or not. And if it is a limit, I am successful because I know it is unique. However, if it is not a limit, I'll have to try another x naught, another x naught. That's a hell of a lot of a job. I don't know the limit, then this definition becomes a little tricky. So therefore, in the case of real numbers, what Cauchy did was look at it in a different angle. Okay, he said that I will take a convergent sequence and look at it from various viewpoints. Okay, so now again we will look at is the property of convergent sequences in R. So let's take 3. After all that, then I'll take a number of examples with all the metric spaces that we have got. Okay, we have several examples of metric spaces. In each one of them, we'll look at some notion, some of these ideas. So suppose Xn tends to x naught in this metric space in our R. Okay, Xn tends to. So what does, again let me definition, write the definition. For every epsilon positive, the chord is played, then chop off chord is played, such that if we chop off that sequence up to the nth stage, then no problem, everybody is within epsilon error of the x naught. That's what the definition of limit. Now let us say take n and m both greater than or equal to n epsilon. So therefore, what I will do is again I will take epsilon 1, epsilon 1, epsilon 1, epsilon 1. Okay. Now take both n and m greater than n epsilon 1. So because both n and m are greater than n epsilon 1, we will have mod xn minus x naught will also be less than epsilon 1, mod yn minus xm minus x naught will also be less than epsilon 1, because both of them are on the side, nice side, they are far enough so that the error is within epsilon. Okay, so what did you say? Here is the sequence x1, x2, etc. You take n epsilon, remove all the previous fellows, the remaining fellows are within a distance of epsilon from x naught. Now your n is also here, m is also here. So both of them will be within a distance of epsilon 1. And therefore, just like before, what will that be? X naught minus xm, which is less than epsilon plus epsilon 1 plus epsilon 1 to epsilon 1. So therefore, maybe, okay, let me first continue this and then put the other. Therefore, given epsilon, given any epsilon positive, choose epsilon 1 equal to epsilon by 2 and get n which will depend on epsilon 1, but epsilon 1 itself depends on epsilon, and therefore we will get an n which will depend on epsilon, such that n and m greater than or equal to n epsilon implies mod xn minus xm is less than. In other words, some kind of a traffic jam taking place. Everybody is bumper to bumper traffic. They are within an epsilon distance of each other. Okay. All the members of the sequence beyond a certain stage will all be clustered within an epsilon distance of each other.
So there is a small interval within which all of them will be members of the sequence will be clustered. That so therefore, if a sequence is converging, it means I don't know where they are converging. Now in this there is no x naught coming in. Wherever they are converging, I am assured that beyond a certain stage, the members are all jamming up with each other. If for any instance two members keep on, however far you go, if the two members keep a fixed positive distance all the time, then there is no chance of convergence. This sort of property is what is known as the Cauchy sequence. A sequence is said to be a Cauchy sequence if beyond a certain stage all the members of the sequence are clustered together. So this leads to the following definition. A sequence of real numbers xn is said to be Cauchy sequence if for every epsilon, for any error, there exists a stage beyond which all the members of the sequence are within a distance epsilon of each other. For any error, there exists a stage beyond which all are within that error each other. Okay, that is what is meant by Cauchy sequence. So what we have shown is whenever you have a convergent sequence, it must be a Cauchy sequence. So what we have heard is convergent sequence implies Cauchy sequence. Whenever a sequence is convergent, we have shown that it is a Cauchy sequence. Now let us take what will happen in a metric space. We have the notion of convergence. There we have the notion of convergence. These definitions are there. Those definitions are there. And therefore this will come. And therefore we will have this. And therefore we will also have this. So similar argument. Similarly, a sequence xn in a metric space X row is said to be a Cauchy sequence if, same thing, for every epsilon, for any error, there exists a stage such that if you go beyond that stage, all the members are clustered. Now I should not mod xn minus xm, what should I write? Rho xn xm is less than okay. And xn convergent implies so every Cauchy, every convergent sequence must necessarily be a Cauchy sequence. So up to this stage, things run parallel exactly like they go in real numbers. Now the structure of the real numbers or the manner in which the real numbers are constructed or the manner in which the real numbers are axiomatized, whichever way you look at real numbers, gives the other way around property. That is, every Cauchy sequence will necessarily be convergent. But you do not have such a construction of a metric space, you do not have such an axiomatization of the general metric space,
therefore in a general metric space you will not have this property. Okay, so in the real number system construction or axiomatization, I will probably someday discuss briefly about these things, okay, gives us that every Cauchy sequence in R must converge. Okay, this need not be true. This property need not be true in a general metric space. We will see examples later, okay, and therefore we will classify metric spaces as two types. One type where this property holds and the other type where this property does not hold, and those metric spaces where these properties hold, there is a hope that we can still carry out our analysis as we did it in the real numbers, because now that property is also granted. So therefore this leads us to the following definition. Therefore, we classify metric spaces depending on whether this property holds or not, and therefore we give a name. For those places where this holds, we give a name. A metric space X row is said to be a complete metric space. Complete metric space if this property holds. What does mean that this property holds? Every Cauchy sequence must converge. So if every Cauchy sequence in X row converges in that metric space, not somewhere else, it converges in X row. That means that limit X naught must be in X row, otherwise we can't even write that. Then we call it a complete metric space. Otherwise we call it incomplete metric space. Something which is not complete will be called an incomplete metric space. Luckily, many of the metric spaces that we deal with are complete metric spaces, and luckily all the metric spaces which are not complete, we can borrow the idea of Cauchy, of what he did in the real numbers, to consider the real numbers and borrow the same idea. And we can embed an incomplete metric space in a complete metric space in an optimal way. Okay. So there is one good ray of hope in that sense. Either a metric space is complete, or if it is not complete, there is a complete metric space inside which this can be embedded in a very systematic manner or in an optimal manner. Exactly like the way Cauchy did it to consider the real number starting from the rational numbers. I will indicate some of these things a little later, maybe in the next class. So that process where you embed an incomplete metric space by using Cauchy sequences into a complete metric space is called the completion process. Every incomplete metric space can be completed. Just like if you had a set which is not closed, we could make it closed by appending all the limit points. That's what we did at the beginning of this class. So like that, what it means is when it says you are incomplete, it means there are going to be some Cauchy sequences which will not have limits. So basically, therefore, we go on appending all those missing fellows and create a bigger space, and that will become complete. So basically, appending whatever was missing. That is the completion process. There is a way of doing it. And that is what is known as the Cauchy's completion process. Okay, so therefore, this idea of convergence is very nice in a complete metric space. What it says is, from the point of view of sequence limits, a complete metric space is self-contained. You don't need anything to be appended. If a sequence, things are getting closer and closer and closer, are getting jammed, finally they are going to jam at a point. That limit will be there. That's what. So in other words, it's a nice self-contained space for limiting processes. A complete metric space is a nice self-contained space for this. Okay. The first example of a complete metric space is what? Because the whole definition was motivated by the real numbers. So that is one example of a metric space, complete metric space. And so some examples, we will look at some of these examples in detail in the next class. Okay. And what are the generalizations of this? Instead of one component, we take n components, and then instead of the usual metric, we take the P metric, and the components can be real or complex. So this is the next level of examples where 1 is less than or equal to P. Remember the infinite metric also gave the maximum of the difference of the. All these are complete metrics. These are all complete metric space. So that's the next level that is good. Okay. Then we had the next level of examples, which were we allowed infinite number of the sequence, but such that the summation mod xi to the power of p is finite. This is 1 less than or equal to p less than infinity. When it came, they are all complete. We will see they are all complete metrics. And also L infinity, what is L infinity? All bounded sequences. They are also metric spaces, complete metric spaces. So all the good examples we have seen are nice complete metric spaces. Now from discrete coordinates, we move to continuum coordinates, which gave us function spaces. So we had continuous functions, real valued in the interval 0, 1, you can see any interval a, b, 0, 1 is only a standardized example. And then we put the metric infinity. What is that metric infinity? The maximum of the difference between ft and gt. Remember that metric. Okay. This is also a complete metric space. Okay. However, on this side, now I will give you some incomplete metric space. If you take only the rational numbers, it is not a
complete metric space. If you complete this metric space, as I said, there is a completion process, you will get this. Another example I will give is, now take continuous functions, but now with the P metric. What is P metric? Remember, the distance between f and g is defined as 0 to 1 mod f t minus g t to the power of p to d t to the power of 1 over 2. This is not complete metric space. Okay. Now, what happens if we complete them? That is where you get the Lebesgue spaces, LPs. Okay, all the capital LP 0, 1 come by completing these spaces. The L1 AB, L1 L2, LP 0, 1, they are all coming from this. So, there are these spaces, so these are incomplete, and this is okay. I will give you one more example before this, probably. Let me call it as 3, and I will put 2 there. Suppose I take all polynomials, real coefficients in the interval 0, 1. Let us take polynomial, previous, all polynomial functions are continuous functions, and I am going to write pt with t between 0 and 1. So, I am going to consider all polynomials with real coefficients with the variable t between 0 and 1. Now, look at the infinite metric. What is the infinite metric? If I take two polynomials p and q, both are continuous functions, so I can define the maximum of p t minus q t for t belonging to 0. This is an incomplete space. Why? We will see the reasons as we go along. This is an incomplete space, and I said if you have an incomplete space, you can complete it by a Cauchy's process. What will I get? I will get precisely C infinity argument, the space of all continuous functions. So, actually the old classical mathematics analysis was this process. I start with some very simple things, I go on doing certain things, and then I find it is inadequate with respect to certain operations. I remove those inadequacies, what do I get? Okay. So, like that, I started with integers, positive integers. It had some inadequacies. I removed them. I got the negative integers. And then it had some inadequacies. I removed them. I got the rational numbers. And rational numbers, some inadequacies, I removed them, I got the real numbers. The same way, I have physically, first the major laws that were studied were the power laws, something varied as t squared, t cube, t to the power of 4, and so on and so forth. These are called the power laws in physics. But then all phenomena could not be expressed by power laws, like mechanics, they said the distance traveled with the initial velocity u and acceleration a, linear motion is s is equal to ut plus half a t squared. Therefore, it involved one power t squared and another power t. So, we wanted to superpose power laws, that gave us polynomials, and the polynomials had some defect. We removed them, we got the continuous function. The continuous functions also have some defects of their own in a way. If you remove them, you get the so called measurable functions, which Lebesgue found out 100 years back. And then you get the so called Lebesgue measurable functions, and you get those, all those LP spaces. And these spaces have the difficulty, and remove those, the inadequacies, you get this. So, what the mathematician does is, he has certain objects. He wants to do some things with them, He goes on carrying on with them until he reaches a stage he requires something new. Only and only then he creates something new. And whenever he creates something new, he creates them very optimally. I need minimum this much. I will take only that. And then I carry on. See, very lazy fellow and very satisfied fellow. He doesn't want too much. See, if I go, I need about 42 rupees for the auto rickshaw to go to the railway station. It's fine if I have 1000 rupees in my pocket. But a mathematician, if he has 40 rupees in his pocket, he will just take 2 more rupees and go. It is like that. Whatever is just missing, only is added. The limit points were missing, add it to get closure. The limits of Cauchy sequences are missing, add them, you get completeness. You take all the positive integers, the other side was missing, add them, you got integers. You didn't look at rational numbers until you came to the problem of dividing. When it came to dividing, these integers were inadequate. So I had to. What did I have to do? I had to take care of all p by q's. Only those I took, rational numbers. I went on working with them until I came to limiting process. Then I found that it is shaky. It was not adequate. Then Cauchy said, what is the correct thing to be added? Those things only added, real numbers. Then the real numbers, he went on carrying on, solving. Everything was okay until he came to quadratic equations, x squared plus 1 equal to 0, he could not solve. What did he do? He just appended what is required. What he got was complex numbers. So these constructions are very, very important. Okay. It is exactly like that. When I go to a comprehensive exam and ask a question, everything except the answer the candidate will say. Go on telling all kinds of things, okay, but the answer will not be there. So what the mathematician wants is nothing more, nothing less. This is it, okay, and that is the precision with which he will carry out all his construction. So this completion is one such construction. So we will see next time examples of all these spaces, why they are complete and so on. And then continue with seeing how to complete a metric space. I'll just indicate, will not do all the details. Okay.